is June 26, 2016, probably better known as the season finale of Game of Thrones. And this is a special episode to us because it's episode 50. We've made it to 50. I'm your host, Casey Cangelosi, and over there is Laurel Black.
Hi.
And Ben Charles.
Hi, everybody.
And Megan Arns, how's it going?
Good. How are you guys?
Doing fine, thanks. And listen, since it is a special episode to us, I can't believe that we've made it all the way to 50. It seems like it kind of just happened. I don't know, just we all of a sudden are at 50, and I thought it'd be great to have a guest who is a personal friend of mine and also really instrumental in helping me get to where I am in my career today. He's the associate professor of percussion, of music at the University of Minnesota, and he's the director of percussion studies there. And Fernando Meza was really the person who invited me to my first really big event, and it was a marimba festival that he hosted in the Twin Cities in 2010, and that's where I met my sponsors like Majestic and at the time Promark. Now that's innovative. But anyway, it was such a big, important thing for my career at that point. And just a big thanks to him. And it's nice to share him with you. So welcome, Fernando Meza. How are you?
Thank you, Casey. And hello, everybody. I'm doing great. It's such a pleasure to be here sharing with you guys for a little bit.
Yeah, great. And what are you working on this summer? Are you playing with the symphony? Are you guys doing anything interesting?
Yes. Well, let's see. We just got done playing, or I just got done playing my last concert with the Minnesota Orchestra. I play with the MO as a first call extra percussionist. They have a relatively small section of three players in the section, so timpani plus three. And obviously, as we all know, you know, an orchestra that size usually needs four and more, of course, depending on the repertoire. But we just finished, the last concert of the season was Mahler 5, and so we played that, and then we did a recording of it the following week under Osmo Vanska, the music director, which was phenomenal. It's a beautiful project, and I think the recording is going to be unbelievable once it's out. So we just got done with that. I'm on my way to Estonia on Wednesday, actually, to coach for YOA, Orchestra of the Americas, which I coach for in the summers. I've been doing that since 2003. And every year there's a residency in a different country. It's usually in the American continent, but they're doing a tour of the Baltic region this year. So there's a residency of 2 weeks in Estonia. So I will be there for that and then fly back for a week to Minneapolis and then go to South America to Ecuador for a week to give a seminar, percussion seminar over there for the National Symphony Orchestra. So that's what's kind of on the fire right now.
Yeah, when was the last time you went home to Costa Rica?
I was in Costa Rica last January, I guess, last time, which was, yeah, the time before that, of course, was with you and Laurel in, you know, the festival in San Jose over there, and yeah, that was great.
Was that last year?
It was. Yes, it was last year.
I remember when you guys went. That's cool.
Yeah,
can you talk more about the YOA program and how you got involved in that and what it is? I've had some friends play in that orchestra before and a colleague who was doing some coaching through the emerging leaders or something.
Yeah, global leaders.
Global leaders, yeah. And it sounded so interesting. Can you tell us more about it?
Absolutely, yeah. YOA, it really used to be called Youth Orchestra of the Americas, and hence the YOA acronym. But since they raised the age a little bit now, you know, it goes up to 30. It's 18 to 30. So they felt like Youth Orchestra was maybe a little, you know, misnomer of sorts. So, but they kept the YOA-Orchestra of the Americas now. And what it is, this is an orchestra comprised of, you know, kind of the best talent from within each country, from Argentina through Canada and the Caribbean islands. So there is geographic representation from every country in the Americas. And it's just an absolutely brilliant group, and I keep being amazed every year, thinking that it just could not get any better. And the following year, it's just like, wow, even better. So it's an amazing group. They have to audition within the country in many places, and then all those kind of winning auditions are sent to the faculty, and then we review those and select from there. And then the orchestra goes, like I said, it's in a different country every year, their residency. All of us in the faculty go to that country for 2 weeks, help the orchestra prepare for the tour, and then they go on tour for the next, you know, few weeks. So it's a fabulous thing, and it's all free for the participants. You know, the organization covers everything: travel, you know, food, transportation, hotel, whatever it is. So yeah, it's wow. Quite.
That's great.
Wow.
I feel very privileged to be part of that, because the faculty of that organization is really fantastic. There's people from all over the world, really, literally, from, you know, principal bass player from the Concertgebouw Orchestra, you know, principal trumpet player from the Rome Opera, you know, former principal flutist of the Boston Symphony, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So,
percussion professor from the University of Minnesota.
Dad. so yeah, that's what I'm saying. I feel very, very honored to be part of that group of people. It's really a great family by now, because we've been together for quite some time, most of us now, in the faculty.
That's awesome.
Yeah. You know, one of our Facebook questions is actually from a Rosendo Suarez, and they would like to know specifically of your experience with Venezuelan students, which I'm assuming is through this program, right?
Well, actually, probably the question from him is not necessarily through YOA connection, but from the time I was in Venezuela, actually on my way to a YOA residency in Brazil. We were that year we had a residency in Bahia in Brazil, but before that I was 10 days in Caracas doing a 10-day seminar for the El Sistema, which, you know, most people might know about El Sistema, but mm-hmm. Big music education program there. And he might be probably referring to that, because I remember meeting him at that time, and it was an amazing thing. They flew about 80 students from all over the country for the seminar that I was offering, and you know, everybody was in the same place where I was, in the same hotel. We ate together in the same restaurant, et cetera, et cetera. So we got an opportunity to really share for quite a while, and it was beautiful. You know, they organized a performance at the end of the seminar, a big percussion ensemble performance that they, you know, played in honor of my giving the seminar, and it really moved me to tears, literally, because at the end they gave me all this, you know, knickknacks, and they gave me a pair of maracas, and they made me an honorary member of Venezuela by giving me this jacket with a Venezuelan flag and all this. It was just very touching, and literally when after that I was supposed to speak, and I just could hardly do it because I was choked up so much. But it was a beautiful, beautiful experience.
Hey, well, speaking of your experiences, and while we're still kind of in the biographical Fernando Meza segment, we have another question that I think sums up a lot of some of the things you've done. But Brad Broomfield says, you performed with the original Lion Cast King, you performed with the original Lion King cast, toured with Keiko Abe, were principal percussionist with the Costa Rican National Symphony Orchestra, arranged one of the greatest marimba gatherings ever, teach at the university, mentor students throughout the Americas. What aging cream do you use? I'm assuming you know this guy, maybe? Brad?
He is Gordon now.
I love that. That's very funny.
Do you know this guy, Megan?
Yeah, he teaches at the position I had in Jordan. He's teaching there now.
Wow. I think that's like the fourth person we've had on the show that's done this thing in Jordan.
Really?
Yeah, really.
Well, I think so, because Kyle, Amy...
Well, he didn't do the thing in Jordan, but almost did. But yeah, Brad, there's only one.
Okay, so
what aging cream do you use?
Well, I would tell you, but I think my what is it that some company that makes beauty products? Revlon. My contract with Revlon has expired.
Some people have signature mallets. He has a signature agent.
I will have to kill you.
Yeah. I've never met Brad personally, but he participated in YOA the 1 year when I was not there. Because one year I actually was coaching for the Youth Philharmonic of Colombia, which is another project that's very close to my heart. And there was a conflict of dates, you know, they were both happening at the same time, and then in conversation with the people from YOA, you know, we decided that I would go to Youth Philharmonic of Colombia that year. And then, you know, they asked me for a replacement, and I recommended Don Liuzzi from the Philadelphia Orchestra, and Don did it. And that's the year when Brad was part of that, which, of course, the craziest part of all of that is that that's the year when the orchestra went through Costa Rica, you know, through my home country. So I missed that one. And, yeah, but, you know, that's just the way it works sometimes. So
that's pretty incredible that, you know the names of all the people, even though you weren't there when he was coaching him. You know, it seems like that says a lot about the orchestra. You know, it seems like the faculty is so close and the orchestra is so close.
Yes. I think everybody on the faculty, you know, is like that, like me. You know, that's what I said earlier, we're like family, you know, and of course, you know, we have to select everybody that comes through the group and all of that, and we spend, you know, 2 weeks that are really, really intense with all these people. And even the year I was not there, yeah, I missed it, but I knew exactly who was coming. You know, I of course had a say in who was going to be coming that year. And so I know Brad from that, even though I've never actually met him.
Right.
So
Fernando, as part of that question, one of the things was saying something about you had performed with Keiko Abe, and she's been a huge influence on my playing, and, you know, obviously many people's playing. Could you tell us about your experience with Miss Abe?
Sure. Well, yeah, and of course, Ben, everybody that knows anything about Keiko Abe knows the huge influence that she is in the percussion world. For me, actually, started pretty early when I was I had just finished high school, and I had come to the U.S. in 1981. And actually, the year before, 1980, I got a scholarship to go to the International Music Camp in North Dakota. That was my senior year in high school, and I studied with Vicky Jenks that summer. And it was the first time I had heard the name of Keiko Abe was through Vicky. The following year, when I came to the U.S., I had gotten another scholarship to come play with the American Wind Symphony Orchestra in Pittsburgh, and to attend Carnegie Mellon University for a year. But that first summer when I came in '81, I met Keiko's first American student, who is Alan Zimmerman. And Alan is no longer, you know, fully involved in music, but he still has his, you know, his finger in the pulse very much of the contemporary music.
I think he's on the board for New Music Marimba, isn't he? Is the president or something?
He most certainly is.
Yeah.
In fact, it was his, I don't know if it was his idea or Bill Marsh's idea, but I think between the two, they kind of cooked that up, and he's still involved in that. But Alan was, you know, a big influence for me that first summer when I came and I saw his playing and all of that, and I was really blown away by it. I never seen anybody play the marimba like that. And then I found out that he was a student of Keiko's. Then the following November, I attended my very first PASIC convention in Indiana, in fact, Indianapolis. And Keiko was playing that year, so I got to see her for the first time that time. And after that year, I attended Baylor University for my bachelor's degree. And Keiko came to Baylor one time to do a master class. Alan Zimmerman had gone through Baylor. Vicky Jenks had gone through Baylor. J.B. Smith, also, who was in the American Wind Symphony with me that first summer I played, had also gone through Baylor. So there was this connection over there. And Keiko, you know, at one time told me that she thought that Larry Van Landingham, who was the teacher at Baylor, and may he rest in peace, we all loved Dr. V, beautiful human being in every sense of the world and word, and great teacher, but Keiko told me he was just a fantastic marimba teacher of the Japanese repertoire, that he really understood that, and so I was very fortunate to study with him and, you know, get to know the rep through him that way. So when Keiko came that year, was my first time interacting with her. I got to play for the master class, played time for marimba, and then finished that, and then she said, oh, that was very nice, blah, 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 and then now you play, and I play too, and so she wanted to improvise at the same time that I was playing. So you can imagine for, you know, a junior in college what that means, you know, when you have that kind of experience of having, you know, the greatest marimbas in the world playing next to you, you know, while you try to keep your composure, you know. But then after that, I had, you know, several other opportunities to exchange in interact with her. Later in Michigan when I was in graduate school, and then in Japan, we did a tour for a month with the percussion ensemble for the University of Michigan, and then did a recording over there of the piece Conversation in the Forest, which actually I could tell you a quick story on that.
So are you on her recording of that piece?
I am, yeah.
Okay, cool. I have that.
It's actually the trio is Michael Udall, Greg Coyle, and myself. So, but it's interesting because that piece, we had toured with that piece prior to the recording, and the piece was called Prism for Marimba and Three Percussionists. Hmm. And so we toured the whole time, and the piece was called that. It was in every program as Prism for Marimba and Three Percussionists. And when we got to the recording, the first portion of the piece, you know, has all these wooden sounds and improvisation, all that. So we did a take of the piece, and then we came back to the booth to listen to it. And as we were listening, you know, Keiko had her headphones on, and she was kind of shaking her head and kind of saying, it's not correct, it's not right. And we were all wondering, you know, what she was finding wrong with what we were doing or whatever, you know. But then in the end, you know, she turned around and she said, no, it's not right. And she turned to the recording engineer and said, you know, the name of this is not right. This sounds so beautiful. All this wood sounds like the forest is just having a conversation.
No
so
way.
When this CD comes out, I want this piece to be called Conversation in the Forest.
Yeah. That's so cool.
So yeah, so that changed right there and then, and that's when it kind of became that name instead of Prism for Marimba and Three Percussionists.
Yeah, wow. And if anyone's not familiar with that piece, I mean the marimba part is all the licks from Prism, but there's like this cool percussion interlude in it. It's very funky, not at all what you would expect from Keiko Abe.
Yes, it's true. It was really fun getting to premiere that and play it around. But and then of course after Japan, I had the privilege of bringing Keiko to my home country in Costa Rica. At the time I was playing as principal with the National Symphony there, and this was in 1990, and so I brought Keiko to Costa Rica and we did a very special concert over there, and so for me to be able to play at home, you know, in front of all my family and friends and colleagues and all of that, that was very special. You know, we got to do her Memories of the Seashore duo. We did Conversation in the Forest, also, which was very special to me, with my first percussion teacher, Stuart Mars, who teaches at the University of Maine. But I wanted to bring Stuart. Stuart was the pioneer of all the percussion school in Costa Rica. Mm-hmm. And so the whole country basically owes Stuart a great, you know, deal of gratitude. So I wanted to bring Stuart to be part of this kind of celebration with Keiko. And it was Stuart and my best friend, Bismarck Fernandez, who was the timpanist in the National Symphony, who was a former also student of Stuart's, and myself. And then Keiko was traveling with three of her former students, actually, because she was doing a tour in Latin America. So we got to play a very special version at the end of the concert of Marimba Spiritual with six percussionists. And it was quite the cultural exchange, because she wanted to incorporate both cultures. So Stuart and Bismarck and I came out wearing Japanese happy coats. And then the Japanese guys came out wearing the traditional little cotton hat and bandana around the neck that the Costa Rican peasant workers wear. And then we did a section of Marimba Spiritual. We added a salsa beat to it. And so it was quite unique. This is the kind of thing that it really only happens once, and that's it, you know?
Yeah. Hmm.
So very special.
You know, to the heart of, I've forgotten his name, Brad's question.
Sure.
You know, he says at the end there, what aging cream do you use? I think he's serious. You know, you have this amazing energy, and, you know, I definitely want to talk about the Marimba Festival at some point, but do you think, I don't know, are you working on some big crazy thing that you're going to reveal soon to us all, or, I mean, how do you have this amazing energy?
Well,
are all Costa Rican percussionists this way?
Yeah, I don't know about that. I know there's a lot of, great players and musicians in Costa Rica that are doing all kinds of things. So I don't know if I'm just trying to keep up with everybody. I'm just trying to keep up with you, Case, is basically what it is. that's the bottom line, you know. No, but I don't really know, you know. It's just there's always something that is motivating me to move forward somehow. There's always a personal project or a professional project or an entrepreneurial project or something that really moves me to do the next thing or to take the next step. There's actually a big project right now which is going to be unveiled at PASIC actually in November. For the last several years, I've been working with a father-son team in marimbas in Costa Rica. And that was a very big decision for me, because that involved my kind of cutting relationships with a company that I had a long relationship with here in the States, and whom I still love, and I think they're great. But I had this very personal project that I wanted to follow up with in terms of helping these guys get their marimbas off the ground and built and all of that. So since 2011, I guess now, I've been helping them from their artistic side of things so that they can better their product. And after 5 years in all of that, now they're going to be bringing their instruments to PASIC in November.
Wow.
So, yeah, I'm very, very excited about that.
Yeah, and Laurel and I saw those instruments and played
them.
That's right. That's right. When you guys were in Costa Rica, we took one of those with us, didn't we? Yeah.
Yeah.
What is the name of the company?
The name of the company is O Biolley, Biolley, and before that, O Biolley Musical Instruments, basically. O Biolley Instrumentos Musicales.
Great.
So, and it is Oscar Biolley, father, and Oscar Biolley, son.
You know, I got to say, though, in the States, it might sell better if the word was real simple, like shotgun marimbas or something.
Yeah, I don't know. They'll have to, decide on that, but...
Isn't something... I might be wrong about this, but one of the really cool things about their instrument, it doesn't use rosewood. Is that right?
That is correct. It is not a rosewood instrument. This is an instrument that is made with Costa Rican wood, and it's called Cristobal. They actually use two different woods, Cristobal and Balsamo. More Cristobal than Balsamo, but either one. You know, those are the woods that have been used traditionally in all of the traditional marimbas or folk marimbas that they have built or that have been built in the country. We have never in Costa Rica, we have never used rosewood for making traditional marimbas. And really, in the traditional marimba, you know, venue the, or street, I don't know how to call it, rosewood has not been the wood used. There's other woods, hormiguillo, etc. But in Costa Rica, they've always used bálsamo or cristobal. And so when these guys decided they were going to make concert instruments, we wanted to try this to see if we could provide an alternative to rosewood, because rosewood is really going through a difficult time right now. You know, there's all kinds of things associated with rosewood that are difficult. You know, there's a black market that is just absolutely insatiable out there. Mm-hmm. And there's and it's really an ugly thing, because, you know, whoever wants to buy rosewood legally, prices keep going up and up and up and up and up. So the instruments mm-hmm. keep getting more and more and more expensive, and so on and so forth. And so the marimbas that these guys are making are not meant to be a replacement for rosewood. I don't think we're ever going to find a wood in the world that sounds like rosewood. That's, I think that's the bottom line. So it's not offered as a replacement, but it is offered as an alternative, which I think we have to, you know, find.
How does the sound compare?
I'm sorry?
How does the sound compare?
You know, to me, you know, we have rosewood, which is kind of like the standard in the industry, and then we have the padauk, which is kind of the only other kind of alternative that we've seen out there. Mm-hmm. To me, you know, this is kind of the in-between. It's, to me, it's better than padauk and not quite as good as rosewood, but mm-hmm. it's, I think it's a really good alternative. And the better part is that, you know, the instruments are not going to be as expensive as rosewood. So a lot more students, for example, and even professionals, you know, are going to be able to find an instrument that is cheaper and that they can afford. So.
Yeah, upon hearing it myself, I would agree. In fact, I may even draw the scale with the Costa Rican wood closer to rosewood, because I thought the quality was very, very, very nice. And it has always bothered me, you know, it's the same material that they make violins and cellos out of, and we just hit it. You know, it's like we hit it until it breaks, and then we
get an endangered species.
It's an endangered species. We just beat it until it breaks.
And we take it out into the sun.
Right, we take it out in the sun, and it's just, I don't know, it's
80 horns.
it's a little heartbreaking, and yeah. You just got to think, you know, a violin is supposed to last forever. You're never going to destroy it by playing it, but you can't help but destroy these by, so I don't know, it's really nice that people are out there and seriously looking for alternatives, because, I don't know, man, in 20 years, it may be a really big deal. It'll probably be a big deal in less than that.
I completely agree. It's something that, you know, it's been in the back of my mind for a number of years, you know, this issue with rosewood. And I don't know, I mean, if it is something, you know, because I grew up in Costa Rica, and so I see the beauty of the natural resources. Costa Rica is such a beautiful country of, you know, nature is so luscious in Costa Rica and all that. But I also see, you know, the deforestation in parts, and I see things, you know, that are happening, of course, around the world. I'm not talking about Costa Rica now necessarily, but around the world. And rosewood is an issue with that, you know. So, yeah, like, you know, like Megan is saying, you know, we take these instruments, you know, and put them in the marching field. And, you know, yes, we're going through bars like nothing.
Right.
And this is an endangered species indeed. And so in 20 years, yeah, when we may not be able to find rosewood anymore, then what's going to happen, you know? So, like I said, it's something that's been in the back of my head for a while. And, you know, investigating a little bit into it, I decided to kind of team up with these guys and help him out to provide an alternative, you know?
Yeah, that's great. Aside from the sloth, the monkeys, the exotic birds, the colorful crabs, all the pretty vegetation we saw in Costa Rica, the thing that stands out in my mind is the spider web that was like as strong as piano wire.
I mean, yeah, there's some pretty amazing animals, man, down there.
including I wanted to go until you said that, Casey.
It all ties together, including the marimba wood is very, see, it's all related. Hey, Megan, where are you and what are you doing, and tell us what's going on.
Yeah, so right now I'm in beautiful New Hampshire. I wish you could see. It's gorgeous. I am at a place called Avaloch Farm Music Institute, and it's a beautiful place where they host artist residencies, and you can come here. You apply with an ensemble or as an individual, and you can apply to spend a week here and have time and space to work with your group on your craft. So I'm here with a group I play with called the Switch Ensemble. It's an electroacoustic mixed instrumentation group, and we live all in different places, so it's really important for us to have something like this because it gives us space and time to work together and learn music. And yeah, it's just really beautiful, and there's a lot of people doing different types of art here, and so it's a great place to meet new people as well and see what other people are up to. And so one person that I ran into here that I didn't know was going to be here is my friend Owen Weaver, another percussionist. And Owen's got a lot of really cool projects going on, and he happens to be a student of Fernando's, a former student of Fernando's. So I asked Owen to drop by, take a break.
Oh my gosh. Hey, Owen.
Well, it's great. It's really nice to have run into Megan here at long last. We had a lot of catching up to do, and she mentioned this podcast was happening, and lo and behold, your name came up, and it's wonderful to see you here. What a great surprise. Thanks, everybody, for letting me drop in here unexpectedly.
Yeah, it's great.
Yeah, happy to have you.
This is Ben here on the left.
Hello, Ben. Pleasure.
Casey.
Hey, Casey. How are you doing?
Howdy.
And hey. Laurel.
Hey, Laurel.
Hey, Owen.
Yeah.
So, Owen, maybe you can just tell us a little bit about a couple of your projects and especially what you're doing here. I can see yes. Owen's cabin, by the way. He has this really cool
yes.
cabin.
So just off screen, we have our cabin in the woods here. And I'm here with a composer and bassist named Florent Gis, who is from Bordeaux, France. He's in the PhD program at Princeton right now in composition. And I approached him about writing a piece for solo percussion and electronics and video, which is something that he does a lot of. So this week has been sort of an exploratory week for us, working with software that he's writing in Max MSP and in Ableton and video software that I've never even heard of before. And we've been doing a lot of recording my playing on the drum set or the glockenspiel, and then he finds ways to manipulate it and play it back sort of either in real time or pre-recorded stuff. So and this is just the perfect place to sort of be secluded and sequestered and just try things, which is very rare, as those of you know, commissioning composers, to actually get a week away from the world and just see what you can come up with. So that's what we're doing here, and it's been very, very fun to really geek out as deeply as we always want to.
That sounds great.
Really
good
as well.
Yes, they have a great chef on staff. Recommended to anybody.
Very good. And it's amazing how like different you feel when you're eating like three regularly spaced healthy meals.
Yes.
Does not always happen, for me at least.
Yeah, great.
And you live in New York City.
Yes, I do. I live in New York, where I'm freelancing and finishing DMA at the Hart School with my main man, Ben Toth. And so I'm playing in a lot of new music ensembles and mantra percussion, a sextet, and Glenn Branca ensemble playing drums with him and his guitar compositions and lots of things like that. And I've also found myself fairly immersed in the world of dance accompanying in some studios, which has been really fun to get to keep the hand drumming chops that I tried to build over the years and get to use them from week to week. And to keep the classes going has been really, really fun. So there's lots going on there. Lots you can do there. Yeah.
Owen, it's great to see you. First
yes,
of all,
you too.
This is a very unexpected surprise. So
it is, yeah. It's such a wonderfully small world.
It's a wonderfully small world, and now that you're saying that your colleague is over there at Princeton, it mm-hmm. is a small world. This just a few days ago I was here with Steve Mackey, composer.
Yeah.
Because he and Jason Truden from Soul Percussion,
that's right,
just premiered a show over here at the Guthrie Theater, which was absolutely brilliant, by the way, just phenomenal. Just Steve on electric guitar and 2 million pedals, you know, to create loops and effects and all. It was just fantastic. And Jason playing drums and, you know, a few gongs, crotales, a wind kind of harmonica type instrument, or I don't know what exactly it was, but and dancers, video. It was just a brilliant, brilliant project. But so, you know, the whole Princeton connection, I was just with Steve Mackey here last week and Jason. And so, yeah, it's fantastic.
Yeah, they're all very well acquainted. And, you know, I'm a fan of that Liquid Music series.
Oh, yeah, of course. From the St. Paul Chamber Orchestra, yeah.
Exactly. Second to none. So, yeah, it is funny. And, you know, what a great surprise. Megan and I had no idea that the other would be here. So just to be able to walk into a place like this and like, oh, well, good to see you. Welcome. Let's hang out this week. And learning about what her ensemble is up to, because they're you know, living all over the country, and they're just coming together here to prepare for this concert in Spain. So it's really exciting to see that taking place as well. So.
And there's some downtime. We went kayaking yesterday.
It's true. It's very true. Very important. Yeah.
Speaking of important things, Owen, I'm going to embarrass myself real quick here, but is your shirt Game of Thrones map?
It is not, but that's a good call. It's got a map on it.
Yes. Yeah.
And, you know, okay. I'm a big fan of books that have maps in the front. Exactly.
Yeah. Right?
Everybody can tell what Casey's thinking about.
It is Sunday, right?
It is Sunday.
Yeah, only 4.5 hours left.
Also, Casey, if I may, it's great to meet you. I don't ever think I've gotten a chance. Many years ago, I remember Fernando telling me, like, oh, this guy Casey, you've got to check him out. He's doing some great things. And so I've known about what you're up to for a long time. It's good to finally see you in the most unexpected of mediums. So this is great.
Oh, cool. Oh, well, thanks, Owen. I appreciate it. And thanks, Fernando, for spreading the good word. So, Laurel, now that I embarrassed myself with that map comment, can you save me with a topic or something legitimate?
Sure. So my topic this week is a departure for me and kind of a left turn from what we've been talking about. But entertainment world, in addition to being season finale of Game of Thrones this week, it's also the week that Led Zeppelin won their plagiarism case against the Wolf Estate. So for anybody who doesn't know what I'm talking about, I'll read a bit of a press release. Led Zeppelin won the case of alleged plagiarism of their iconic Stairway to Heaven against the estate of Roger California. The duo is being sued by the estate of Randy Wolf, also known as Randy California, the guitarist of rock band Spirit, over the 1971 song, which appeared on the album Led Zeppelin IV and sold over 37 million copies. So during the late 1960s, Zeppelin opened for Spirit during a U.S. tour, and around that time, hanging out backstage, Roger California had written the song Taurus, which is this instrumental song from one of their albums, and the legend has it that Roger Plant or whoever heard this song and that took the riff, and it's part of Stairway to Heaven. And so Roger Wolf's estate decided that they were going to sue those who were left of Led Zeppelin. They first brought the lawsuit to court in 2014, but it wasn't until this week that a jury decided that, no, there's no plagiarism here. And this is just the first, or the latest, I should say, in a string of these types of cases that have kind of been talking about big money in the world of, you know, kind of pop music, and these issues of plagiarism. And, you know, that's, to me, that's kind of interesting, because within one genre of not classical music, it's amazing how similar they can all sound. Like, if you're not an avid listener of all the bands of a certain genre, or close to all the bands, I should say, it's amazing how similar they sound to you. And even all of us as trained musicians, it's amazing how similar all of it can sound in many ways. But this Led Zeppelin case is the most recent, and the one before that that gained some really high-profile press was the one of Marvin Gaye's estate against Robin Thicke and Pharrell Williams. Have you guys heard about that one?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, about the Blurred Lines suit. So for anybody out there that doesn't know, in March 2015, a jury found Blurred Lines co-songwriters Robin Thicke, Pharrell Williams liable, requiring them to pay the family of Marvin Gaye more than $7 million. Williams would later get back $1 million in an appeal, but even that was not without promising a portion of all sales. I think it was 50% of that song from here on out going to the Marvin Gaye estate. And the family of Marvin Gaye even pushed for that song to never be sold again. Which is, I thought that was kind of odd. It's like, wait, if you're going to get some money from it, just accept it. But yeah, so this is something that I think has been bugging a lot of popular artists for a long time. And an article I read, I think it was in, it was either BBC or Rolling Stone something, but they actually interviewed a professor from the Mannes School of Music just about this. And he said probably what a lot of us are thinking in terms of the Led Zeppelin case specifically and the portion of the song in question. He says, with both songs, the bass line starts on A and keeps descending through the riff. And the A minor chord played by the guitar and guitarist stays the same as the bass line changes. But in Stairway, the melody changes, often in contrary motion to the bass line, not at all the same structure, as we would all agree, as we would all know. And then he adds, there are hundreds and hundreds of songs that use the same progression of four chords over and over again, many songs from the 1960s and 1970s, not to mention those from the 1760s, use the same four chords repeated in a different order. And when I read that, I was like, thank you for saying it, because... You know, and that's not to, like, dog on any four-chord music. I love it. We all do, which is why it stays popular, you know, and that's great. But it's kind of, it's interesting to me that people would actually try to claim ownership over something like that. It's almost like a drummer saying, you know, no, I came up with the white man beat 100 years ago. It's mine. You copied it in your recording. You can't play it. It's like, no, dude. There's some things that are so basic. I don't know if you can actually call it plagiarism. And this idea goes back such a long way. I kind of went down a rabbit hole of, you know, tunes that borrow from other tunes, and I got to looking at jazz standards, and Autumn Leaves, which is one that probably everybody's heard of, has an entire website devoted to it in some ways, not about plagiarism, but about how many writers it's had and how many lyricists have claimed ownership over certain lyrics, but really all they did was translate something, and Johnny Mercer is the one that wrote the English lyrics, and so we tend to think that he wrote it, but he didn't. It was written a long time before that, and the chords, which are, you know, sometimes in jazz curriculums noted as being kind of innovative and so different. The author of this website is a trained musician and actually found the same progressions in Haydn and Mozart. So, you know, in terms of harmony and progression, it's not a thing that you can claim plagiarism on, at least not to me. And additionally, in the early 20th century, it was very, very common for people to take classical themes, classical melodies, and just throw them in to popular songs. And I know that my grandparents listened to a lot of that kind of music, so I kind of grew up hearing it. And, like, for example, Freddie Martin has the song Tonight We Love. Does anybody know that song? No? Okay. I was totally born in the wrong decade, so that's why I know that song. But it takes the melody from Tchaikovsky's first piano concerto. So he just wrote words to it, and that's the song. And it was this crazy hit song in the early 20th century. So a few years later, a guy named Jackie Wilson wrote different words to it, and it was a his song, again, using the same melody and harmony, neither of which was written by either of those two guys. And, yeah, so I'm not totally sure what this plagiarism stuff is about, other than maybe trying to get some money out of it. And, you know, to that extent, if these guys today knew that they were going to borrow so heavily, you just ask, I don't know, or you pay some royalties up front, or you give them credit, and then you avoid all of this.
Yeah, it's interesting. It keeps coming up.
Maybe in some way, people that are pushing this don't aren't musicians, you know? So, like, maybe they don't really understand the way music functionally works, like, on a practical level.
That's what I'm thinking.
I wonder if they see it as stealing the likeness, you know, because sometimes people will sue, what was it, I know, what's her name, the girl in Mean Girls, what's her name?
I think it's great that none of us know this. This is awesome.
Lindsay Lohan?
Is that Rachel
McAdams? Yeah, Lindsay Lohan sued Rockstar Video Games for stealing her likeness in one of their Grand Theft Auto games, and I don't remember how it worked out, but I wonder if they see it as you're stealing the likeness, and they're not worried about the specific musicality, and then when they do try to prove it, they go down to the musical components and then find out, like, oh, wow, it would be such an easy defense. Like you said, Laurel, you would simply go, well, look, that's kind of how the pop world is, and this has happened over and over and over and over. And
I think it boils down to a few things, and one of which is Laurel's kind of touched on, and that's that we have 12 notes. There's only a finite amount of combinations, unless you start getting into, you know, really bizarre sounding melodies that are going to be singable, familiar sounding melodies. And it's funny, like when Laurel was mentioning the. What was the song that had the melody from Tchaikovsky?
Tonight We Love.
There's a piece, it's a famous French art song called Pièce d'Amour, and Keiko Abe actually has a marimba version of this tune. It's also the exact same melody from an Elvis tune called Can't Help Falling In Love With You.
Yes.
So that's, you know, just a little interesting thing to me. But I just wanted to rattle off a few other of these sorts of scenarios that came to mind for me. One, I think probably the most famous one of all time is Queen Under Pressure and Vanilla Ice, Ice Ice Baby.
Yeah.
He rips off like the bass riff from that. And initially he didn't credit Queen, when that is clearly a sample of that. It's not like he was copying a melodic contour or the beat of the song or something. He sampled that bass line. And I don't know what legally happened there. I know he initially didn't credit them, so I'm assuming eventually they got credit, and, you know, Queen probably collected royalties from it or something. The other one that really comes to mind for me, because I'm a huge Beatles fan, is George Harrison, My Sweet Lord, where George basically, what I was looking it up online while Laura was talking about it, he subconsciously plagiarized a song called He's So Fine, where he had heard the song and he like woke up and wrote his own song, and it wasn't until it was produced and recorded that someone said, hey, this sounds exactly like this other song, and he got nailed with a big lawsuit over it, and it dragged on, and there was, you know, many problems with that. But it's interesting, like, this has been happening forever, people like sampling. And my favorite example of what we could call sampling is actually by Leonard Bernstein. If you know the tune Somewhere from West Side Story, the first part of that melody is actually from the Beethoven Emperor Concerto, the minor seventh rise, da-dee-da-da-dum. And it's funny, because when I hear that in Beethoven now, it sounds like Bernstein to me. It doesn't sound like Beethoven. And then the next part is actually from Strauss Burlesque. The da 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 dee da dum is ripped off of Strauss. And then the next part is from Tchaikovsky's Swan Lake. So it's like Bernstein literally just ripped off three like classical composers. And we don't like accuse Bernstein of plagiarism. And I don't think Bernstein was making any secret or trying to keep it, you know, that was his melody. But it's funny how when it's that well done, it can be like a tribute to other people, but also, you know, made into your own thing. I think the issue comes when you're profiting heavily off of another living artist is where I think the issue mm-hmm. comes. And, you know, I know there's all sorts of legal things about you can't copyright a feel because then you can claim, you know, I don't know, all that. But right. How many marimba pieces are exactly like Keiko Abe marimba pieces, you know?
Oh, exactly. Well, and I actually looked up, you know, if Tchaikovsky's living family ever tried to go after those guys that took the melody and the tempo and the chord, like, they just blatantly copied it. And I couldn't find anything, but I don't know when the laws came about public domain and so yeah. on, about that kind of stuff. So that might have something to do with it.
Yeah, that's true.
And the laws really have to change to reflect the times and the medias that we're using. And copyright law is pretty thorny, and I don't know much about it. But with these examples that you mentioned, Laurel, with you know, the Marvin Gaye estate and Robin Thicke, and really, if you put Stairway and Taurus back to back, it's pretty uncannily similar.
Yeah.
You can't hear that and not think, this must have been influenced in a pretty major way. But I think the problem with these lawsuits and enacting them is that even if they're in the right and they do serve some sort of justice, it's kind of a slippery slope, and it sets a potentially dangerous precedent for what we can go after and whom and why. And I think, because you're right, Ben, there's some great examples there, too, of things that are similar or as an homage or an influence or an unconscious influence. And so if everybody is just going after everyone else all the time for stealing a riff, I mean, that's how all music is created. So it's really difficult to pick and choose sometimes, but I would feel slighted if I were in the band Taurus, but I have to take a step back and be like, or not if I wrote the song Taurus, but I have to sort of remove myself and be like, well, does this really serve, you know, music on the whole or not?
Yeah, well, it's also tough because the judge isn't necessarily a musician. You're trying to explain mm-hmm. sort of complex musical things to...
Yeah.
Well, and I bet Megan hit it right on the head. It's probably not coming from the musicians directly in a lot of these cases. It's coming from the ownership of that song. It's so complicated. So I wonder if it's...
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, the
well, in both of these cases I mentioned, it's the estate. It's the right. living members who could be making lots of money off royalties
right.
that are doing it. And I'm sure there's a bit of principle in there, too, particularly with the Robin Thicke song, just because it's kind of, I don't know, I find it kind of gross. But
I like what Ben said about Bernstein and the quotations from the other composers, because it seems like composers have been winking at each other in their compositions for, since forever. Hey, I want to tell you guys, I saw a funny meme on Facebook. It was a Trump meme, and one of my students posted it, and it had Trump, and it said, "We're going to build a wall, and Pink Floyd's going to pay for it."
Very good. That's funny.
Fernando, I really want to hear your thoughts about this. We've all been talking a lot, and you've kind of been quiet.
Yeah, I know. I've been listening. You know, I mean, I'm certainly not any kind of expert on that. You know, I think is the issue is, you know, if there's money to be made by going after somebody, someone's going to go after somebody. You know what I'm saying? That's just going to happen. I think that's probably more latent in the pop music world, where there's real money, you know what I'm saying, where there's a lot of money
right.
made. So, you know, I've never, you know, in anything that I've ever had to do, have dealt with the kind of money that is generated by, you know, by an act like, you know, Marvin Gaye or whatever it might be, you know what I'm saying, songs by an artist like that. I guess the closest I've been to that is through, you know, Lion King, you know, as a Broadway show, but that's, you know, that's not anywhere close to what, you know, you guys have been talking about here. So I think there's certainly a financial component to that, you know, outside of the issue that Owen was talking about, you know, in terms of, you know, considering the validity of music, or with Megan, I forget who was mentioned that, but, you know, does it do something good for the world of music altogether? I think it goes first and foremost to the, you know, to the pocketbook of somebody who wants to just make a lot of money in the process, you know.
It's a good example of when people say, hey, maybe if you guys played more poppy stuff, you'd be more popular. It's like, oh, why do we want to be popular again? Because it's because it sounds like it kind of sucks, you know, aside from, you know, there's a lot of baggage that comes with being popular in that way. And speaking of popular, Ben, I think you were going to talk about a composer real quick who...
Oh, I thought you were going to say I'm popular.
Excited. Popular.
That's what it sounded.
He's, like, anyway, he's popular.
I'm super popular. I have like over 1,000 Facebook friends. I don't even know if I do. No, anyway, yeah, well, we're having Fernando on, and I know an artist that he has worked closely with is Nebojsa Zivkovic, so I wanted to talk a little bit about Nebojsa today. First of all, the pronunciation of his name, if you go on his website, there's actually an audio clip of him saying his own name so that you can pronounce it correctly, which is very him. But anyway, to go over it, I'll pronounce it this one time perfectly correctly, and then probably not again the rest of the episode, but I'll try. I practice several times ahead of time. It is Nebojsa Jovan Zivkovic is the correct pronunciation. So there you have it.
He would be very proud of you, Ben.
What's that?
He would be very proud of you.
I'm just as guilty of error. It's not pronounced Zivkovic, even though it's spelled with a Z. It's Zivkovic. So there you have it. Anyway, Zivkovic was born in 1962 in Serbia, which at the time was Yugoslavia. For anyone not great with geography, which I wasn't before I researched this, Serbia is in the Balkan Peninsula, which if you know where Italy is, to the east of Italy is the Adriatic Sea, and then it's the next sort of peninsula over in Europe, and it includes Bulgaria, Macedonia, Bosnia, Serbia, a couple of others. So anyway, as a kid, Zivkovic wanted to play drums, but he was told that drums are not a real instrument because they don't make music, they only make rhythm, and he was offered a trumpet, which he refused to study, so his mother put him in piano class for 4 years. Then finally, when he was 14 years old, he got a drum set and could, you know, start to play drums. There was no music shop in his hometown, so he didn't have a whole lot of resources. And he told a story about one time he traveled to see his cousin in Sarajevo, and he found a book called Polish School for Snare Drum. And it was a Saturday, so there was nowhere he could, you know, at that point in time, there was nowhere open that he could go make photocopies of the book. So he actually, in one day, sat there and wrote the whole thing out by hand. He copied it by hand so he would have something to study. So clearly someone that was very determined to study music. Then finally, when he was 16, he enrolled in a musical high school in Serbia. Following that, he went to study music in college at the University of Music and Performing Arts in Mannheim. He had already studied solfege and music theory, so he was actually more advanced in that regard than the rest of his class. So the teacher proposed that he did a double degree in music theory as well, and then additionally he got a degree in addition to theory and percussion and composition. So he had 3 undergraduate degrees, and then he went to the State University of Music and Performing Arts at Stuttgart, and completed 2 master's degrees, 1 in percussion and 1 in composition. So quite, again, a very determined kind of brilliant musician. And so because of this, a lot of his works are not typically percussionist-composed works, meaning that they're not just permutations applied over chord changes on the marimba. They're very compositionally sound and kind of historically European composition-based, you could say. As a performer, he's performed internationally, including the USA, Japan, Taiwan, Russia, Germany, and Australia. He's been a soloist with the Minnesota Orchestra, St. Petersburg Philharmonic, and the National Symphony Orchestra in Costa Rica, as well as many others. He performs on a custom Yamaha marimba. And as a composer, he says that he draws influence from European classicism, including especially Shostakovich and Mahler, rock and roll, especially kind of big-time John Bonham rock and roll drummers, his Balkan heritage, which you see a lot of his pieces have kind of weird mixed-meter grooves that draw from the sort of Balkan Peninsula grooves. I know that Svet Stoyanov and his Bulgarian music has shown me some like 13/8 sort of odd grooves. He's written around 40 pieces, mostly for percussion, but not exclusively. He actually has a horn concerto a cello concerto, solo works for violin and contrabass, and chamber works that include flute, oboe, clarinet, horn, bassoon, and trombone. His works range from beginner pieces, mostly in his Funny Mallets series, which probably most of us are familiar with, all the way up to very virtuosic works, including pieces like Ultimatum and Fluctus. And then a lot of his works are sort of staples, standards in the repertoire, you could say, like Ilyash, Uneven Souls, and To the Gods of Rhythm, and Trio per Uno is also another really super popular one. His more recent compositions include a double percussion concerto called Obsessions, a percussion trio called Sandy the Hurricane, and a marimba solo called Homo Balkanicus. And then in my research, I found kind of one of my favorite quotes from him was, I think a lot of performers, especially students, are afraid of missing notes. And when you watch someone on stage, you can often tell when they're afraid of missing notes. And he flat out in an interview said, "I will always give at least 5 wrong notes in any good performance," which I think kind of is a nice sigh of relief that we can all breathe that it's okay to miss a few notes here and there in a great performance. So anyway, that's kind of my as fast as I could get through it, Zivkovic, because I wanted to hear from Fernando about his experiences.
Why could I tell you about Nebojsa, man? Nebojsa he's quite a character, to be sure. But he's, Nebojsa is actually a dear friend of mine, and I guess in order to really understand Nebojsa, you have to understand, where he comes from, his background, his history, his surroundings, his family, everything, I remember being in his parents' home in Sremska Mitrovica, the town where he was born.
See, I was not about to attempt to say that one.
Yeah. when I was there, I'm looking back here. In fact, let me just grab it real quick. I have this. I don't know if you can see it. Tell me if you can see it clearly or not.
Yeah.
Yes.
Can you see it okay?
Your object. I recognize this.
Yeah. Well, this is a beautiful metal kind of pounded from the back.
Uh-huh.
And anyway, this was in Nebojsa's parents' home, but when we were over there,
you just took it.
And no. I looked at it and I kept looking at it because it was so beautiful. I just think it's a lovely representation,
Yeah.
A Muslim woman covered in, it's just really beautiful. But yeah. I kept looking at it and I kept thinking that that it really made me think, about many things, And so I told his mom, I said, "This is a really beautiful piece." And she goes, "Oh, thank you. She didn't speak much English, but then we sat down to eat and I think she caught me looking at it again, and then she got up from the table and went over and took it off the wall and brought it over and gave it to me.
Oh.
And I said, "Oh, no, I cannot possibly take this." She goes, Fernando. And she just pushed it onto my hands, I said, "Please, no. She goes, "Fernando." So I took it and I gave her a big hug. I said, "Okay, thanks, Mama. Thank you, And it was really a lot of fun. But so there's many things, about Nebojsa that I've shared, both with him and having been to Serbia with him on tour at one time. When we did several tours, actually, that was, I think, the first time that I was in Europe with him. We did a tour first in Germany, and then we drove all the way to Serbia with Ben Toth, actually. Now we have Owen here. That's his teacher at the Hart School. So it was Ben and Markus Hauke from Germany, and Nebojsa and myself. But then we did another tour in Lithuania a few years later, and you mentioned the recording or the composition of Trio per Uno. I was lucky to be in the premiere recording of that as well with Nebojsa and the premiere run of the piece, which actually is another funny story. I was actually in the Dominican Republic playing with the National Symphony of the DR when Nebojsa was sending me two or three or five bars at a time of what is now the, what movement is it? It's either one or three. You know, we did that piece with the, you know, the bass drum movement, the bass drum and the gongs and the bongo. We did it either as the first movement or the third movement. In the
yeah,
end,
I know the first movement now, which is the one with the bass drum and the bongos, was originally the third.
Yeah, we tried it both ways, and in the end, I guess he put it as first. But he was sending me, you know, just snippets of that as he was composing it, because I was supposed to arrive in Germany, and we were gonna hit the ground running and rehearse 2 days, and then, you know, go on tour, and then eventually record the piece. So he was sending me, you know, two bars, five bars when I was in the DR just days before I went to the Germany to do that. So it was just kind of funny. But Nebojsa was, you know, I first met Nebojsa actually at PASIC because he came to play the premiere of Uneven Souls with the University of Maine Percussion Ensemble in 2002. And, of course, the University of Maine is directed by my first teacher, Stuart Mars. So I met Nebojsa through Stuart after they premiered Uneven Souls, and then in 2005, I believe it was, I had Nebojsa here at the University of Minnesota for one semester as an artist in residence, and so that was very special, a very intense semester, obviously, for everyone around here. But and we got to play a lot of, we did a whole recital of his music, which was not just percussion music. We did a bunch of other pieces for other instruments. Because you mentioned, you know, he has a lot of pieces he has for percussion, which everyone probably listening to this podcast is going to know. But he's got a lot of other music, you know, out there. And he's a great orchestrator and, you know, writes very well for other instruments. So... But so yeah, I got a chance to, you know, to tour with him in Europe, you know, a couple times, and then in the States we played 10 years after the premiere of Uneven Souls. We did the premiere of Lamento e Danza Barbara, which is another fabulous piece, marimba solo and three percussionists, that we also got to record Ben and at that time one of Ben's former students, Craig Bitterman.
Ben Toth, by the way, not me.
I'm sorry?
Ben Toth, not me.
Yeah, Ben Toth. Ben Toth and Craig Bitterman and I. And that recording we did here at the U of Minnesota, as actually was also the recording of his two piano, two percussion piece that he, you know, he still hasn't put that one out on CD. I don't know that that will ever come out on CD because I think he probably doesn't want to do much more CDs. He's probably do digital. But that recording will come out hopefully at some point because we did that a few years ago. The Arten des Wassers is called this piece, The Art of the Waters, for two pianos and two percussion. It's really a fantastic piece also. So, yeah, I've gotten to, you know, to collaborate with Nebojsa in many things, and we're very good friends, and yeah.
It's great to hear your story with him because I think so often people hear about you or maybe just look at your resume real quickly and think, oh yeah, okay, so he's like a Latin guy and Nebojsa is like a composer guy and you'd never know that. The time I've spent with Nebojsa, yeah, he's talking about you and Ben Toth all the time, and then the time I've spent with Fernando, he's talking about Nebojsa and Ben Toth all the time, and it's just amazing, again, this small world and connectivity
actually,
and everything.
Quick. Casey, you were on the faculty of his marimba or his percussion academy. Is that correct?
Yeah, I forget if he called it percussion academy or marimba academy, Sorry?
What year was that?
I don't remember. It was the last one he did in the castle.
Gotcha. Because the same interview that I was like, most of my information came from. They asked him who are some of your favorite percussionists. Or, you know, people that you think kind of changed the game. And he mentioned Keiko Abe and Lee Stevens, but he said one of his favorites is his young colleague, Casey Cangelosi. So.
Victory.
Nice!
Victory.
That's what he should.
There's a lot of support here. Yeah, from Fernando, Nebojsa.
Yeah. I was impressed with Nebojsa at the PASIC held right after Hurricane Sandy.
Yeah.
Which I'm assuming is the inspiration for that piece he wrote called like Sandy the Hurricane or whatever.
It was, yeah.
Yeah, when the two guys he was supposed to play with missed his concert because their flight was delayed to the point of being days late, and he just stood up there
I think there were two groups, and one didn't make it, and the other arrived like, you know, an hour before or something. They couldn't have rehearsed. But yeah, and it was like one of the most impressive things to see this guy go up, completely scrap his prepared masterclass, and still perform and do a class, and it was great.
Well, and that's something I can say I've seen in both Fernando and Nebojsa. Fernando, I've seen you give class after class after class in Argentina and in Costa Rica, and there, I guess, at least twice in Minnesota. We seem to overlap a lot. But just the ability to get up and go and never let there be a dull moment in the clinic or in the master class, and it's just it's a really handy clinician trait that I know I'm always working on.
Yeah, no, that's a great point. And I just want to say I have to sign off here in a moment, but Fernando, it's so great to hear you talk about those sort of, now we look at them as seminal pieces and recordings that you were working on, and he seemed to be making several guest appearances while I was in my undergrad. I remember he was always around in some way. The specter of Nebojsa was always looming large, and he would come and give the most, Casey, like you're saying, you know, the most colorful and engaging master classes. I still remember him working with Matt Holm on a piece and like just working on sound production and all these different considerations. And yeah, and it was then that Ben and Craig came through and you did your recital and recording. And, you know, that was obviously a formative period for me. So to be exposed to that in person had a really lasting impact. I mean, there you are, Fernando, in a room where I learned such a great many things, you know. So it's so fun to hear you talk about your experiences with him back then. It's very, very nice to hear.
And of course, the only reason, you know, why I do this, Owen, is so that I can see people like you on the other side doing your thing, you know. That's the real motivator, you know, to see your students going out and reaching for their own dreams too and pursuing their goals and all of that. I mean, that's the reason why any of us in the educational world do what we do. It's a real privilege, you know. So it's great to see you too. And all of this, you know, all of this connection, certainly in the music world, are, you know, we all know the theory of 6 degrees of separation, you know. In music, yeah. I keep saying it's two, you know, 2 degrees. And that's it.
Yes.
Yeah.
It's a very small world, but you know, we're all trying to do our thing and contribute, you know, our little grain of sand to the building of the castle somehow, you know, the sand castle.
Well, we've talked a lot about Fernando, the entrepreneur, Fernando, the artist, and we're just barely talking about Fernando, the... Hey, see you, Owen. Thanks so much for joining us.
It's a pleasure. I'll see you at dinner. Okay.
But we've hardly talked about Fernando the pedagogue, and Fernando is also a phenomenal teacher, and I believe Catherine Yuriel is one of your students, right, Fernando?
Yeah.
Yuriel, thank you. I always wondered. I do remember meeting her. I've met her at a few different places, actually, but she asked Fernando, in your opinion, what is one of the most important things that a young percussionist should keep in mind as they begin to enter the professional arena?
Well, let's see. I mean, I think, you know, nowadays, the two things. One is the ability to have a really, really wide background and to really have a lot of bases covered and available to you at your disposal. In other words, if somebody were to call you to sub with an orchestra, you know, have your orchestral chops in place. If somebody, you know, if you yourself wanted to go and pursue a particular project, let's say a solo marimba, obviously that's going to be something out of your own interest that you're going to be creating. So that's kind of a given. You're going to be preparing towards that. But while you're doing the things that you want to do, be also able to take advantage of the opportunities that present themselves to you. I think this is an important thing, and I said two things. One is create that little niche for yourself where you think your strengths your passion, all of those things collide and combine so that you can really pursue a path that represents you as a musician fully, and where you can really invest of yourself in kind of setting that path for yourself, but also make sure that you are able to take advantage of the opportunities within the music world to be successful out there. I guess I always take, you know, and as we all do, you know, we share what we do from our own experiences. You know, we cannot talk about the things that we don't do. But when you experience certain things, you know that either they worked like this, or they really work well, or they work phenomenally. But you have a way to gauge where that experience fits. And in my own experiences, those that have always been kind of at the top are the ones where I have been able to interact with other musicians of really high caliber. And that's one thing that motivates me, for example. So as I like to prepare myself to go out there, I know that I have to work at a certain level in order to be able to interact with these people that I admire and respect. So I am going to be, you know, preparing myself to be able to function at that level. I know that if I'm going to be playing a duo with Casey Cangelosi, you know, I better be able to play, you know, because Casey can really play, you know what I'm saying? If I'm going to be...
I was scared when we played that duo together, because you can really play.
So, but you know what I'm saying, you know, if you're going to do a duo with Keiko Abe or with Nebojsa or with whomever, you know, make sure that you can do your thing. That's one thing, and also be able to take advantage of opportunities that might present themselves to you. I always use the example of Lion King for me, because that was a little bit outside of my norm, but I was able to take advantage of that, and that was still to this day one of the best experiences in my professional career. The Broadway show of Lion King premiered here in Minneapolis, I think in 1995. I'm sorry, in 1995, I think. And everybody that came, we all knew in Minneapolis that show was going to be coming to premiere here. And so the buzz out in the kind of in the world out there, percussion world, the freelance world, everybody was really excited because, you know, this show was coming. And based on the movie that everybody knew by then, the theme being, you know, Africa and this and that, they all knew that it would probably have a lot of percussion, and so everybody was really excited that it would come. Well, of course, it was all of that, but everybody that was coming to play the show had already been hired in New York, so there was not going to be any local hiring, you know? And they actually did hire, you know, some strings and some brass players and all that, but the main core, you know, bass, although, no, that's not true. The bass player was hired locally here. But all the synthesizer and piano and keyboards and all of that and the flutes and all of that were all coming from New York, as well as the percussionist. But 2 weeks before the show came to Minnesota to premiere, and he had already been in New York, I think, a couple months, you know, practicing or preparing. And this was, by the way, the percussionist for that at that time was Valerie Naranjo. Valerie was serving as kind of the principal percussionist of the section. Then Junior Weatherburn, this guy from Jamaica, Tom Brett from Canada, and Tommy Igo playing drums. And there was one more percussionist that they actually let go 2 weeks before the show came. So they couldn't find somebody in New York to commit to the two-month run that it was going to be here in Minneapolis. So they called a music contractor here in town and asked him to hire a local percussionist. I didn't know this contractor at all, but he eventually called me and asked me if I was interested in doing the show. And I said, well, sure, you know, I'll be interested. Let's talk about it. And at that point, and this is the story I like to share with my students, is that he told me that he had a list of players already, you know, that he knew and that he would call. But all of those people had told him that they really couldn't do this show, which, you know, I told him that I was excited about that because it was a good signal that everybody was busy here in town. But he told me that it was not necessarily that, but the fact that there was something or other that they could not actually do. You know, like, the show involved many things. It involved orchestral playing. It involved writing kind of your own part, because the five percussionists were working together to develop all the grooves. And it involved African drumming. It involved Latin drumming, taiko drumming. And so there was something or other, you know, somebody could read music really well but couldn't really do the hand drumming. Somebody could do the hand drumming really well but couldn't really, you know, improvise. Or this or that or the other, whatever it was. So when he asked me if I was comfortable with that, I said, yeah, you know, I mean, I'm comfortable with all the things you mentioned. So I may not be an expert necessarily in all of them. I think it's impossible really to be an expert at everything out in the percussion world. It's impossible. We all know that. But I think if you have enough of a background and enough of an, you know, understanding of many things, there are opportunities out there that can come your way and you can really take advantage of them. And this was really a phenomenal experience for me. So this is just kind of what I would answer, I guess, to that question of Catherine. Be really versatile and carve your niche where you feel like your specialties might be.
Speaking of this well-roundedness, and another question is from Ted Jackson, and he asks, do you, I'm just going to paraphrase his question to kind of make it fit to this, but he asks, are there certain things that programs are doing that, you know, sorry, what piece of that well-roundedness do you think a lot of programs are missing, if any?
Well, you know, I mean, I don't necessarily want to say that programs are not doing, you know, X, Y, or Z. I think programs do what they do because they have found their recipe for success in what they do. For me, I think one of the important things today for percussionists is really understanding, you know, all of the orchestral instruments, you know, that we all know. And the marimba on the side, kind of as part of that, you know, in terms of the basic understanding, but not as a solo instrument. You know, if you want to be a solo marimbas, that's kind of a separate area for me, you know. But understand the techniques and be able to get around the instrument in the same way that you would around the timpani or the snare drum or whatever. But areas that really need to be addressed are the areas of hand drumming, drum set, in orchestral percussion. I think if you have those bases covered, all of the other things outside of that, you know, if you want to study gamelan, if you want to study tabla, if you want to study, you know, frame drumming, etc., all of those go into the area of specialized fields, you know, or more specialty. But you have to be able to, you know, to sit behind the timpani or any other orchestral instruments, accessories included. You have to be able to get around the four mallet world, marimba vibes, etc. You have to be able to get around the drum set somehow, and you have to be able to get around the hand drumming arena somehow. From there on, you know, it's specialties. You know, there are schools that are very heavily going into the contemporary music world. There are others that are going very heavily into the kind of ethnic traditions of percussion, etc., you know, steel drum and so on and so forth. So I'm not saying that schools should do this or should do that. I just think there has to be a well-roundedness to the education process for all students, and then, you know, a way to really invest time and energy and effort into whatever their passions are for the specialties that they want to pursue.
Okay. I was going to ask, do you know, you probably had a difficult student that says, well, I just want to be an orchestral timpanist. Why am I spending any time playing the marimba or something? But so I guess the thing is well-rounded and then a passion, a specialty.
Yeah, that's kind of how I see it, Casey. You know, I mean, we all know the competitiveness, obviously, of the field, you know, and how you know, difficult it is to actually make a living in this field. So in order to have the best chance at that, you know, be really well-rounded, you know, and then have a specialty area that really showcases who you are as a musician.
Great, great. Well, man, You guys, we didn't even talk about the 2010 Marimba Festival, but it's time to wrap. So
Fernando hosted the Marimba Festival in 2010. Done.
It was really big, and there was a volcano, which kind of messed everything up.
If you can see that poster behind Fernando, just at about 1 o'clock in the shot.
Yeah,
there are so many signatures. When I explain this festival, I explain, when people say, oh, well, who all was there, I actually just talk about who wasn't there because it takes less time.
And there's like maybe three people that weren't there as far as like big marimba players. I mean, it's...
Here's the poster that Casey's talking about.
Oh, yes, thank you.
That's amazing. You can see it.
I don't know if you can see it or if the reflection is bad.
Yeah, no, it's all right. Yeah, it's good. Yeah.
So I guess the question is, when are you doing this again, or do you think you would ever do
this again? Yeah, you know, it's not really going to happen, Megan, that I do another one. That was a dream that I had for many years, really 15 years in my head and 3 years in the making, so a total of 18 years. And I'm not doing it again unless there is unless the money is in the bank beforehand.
Yeah. So. Yeah.
It was really difficult to do, but I'm glad I did it.
Yeah.
Well, you know, and that's where I met Casey, so that was the big plus.
Was it
was such an important thing for me. I had done some clinics and things like that, and, you know, some pieces were moving around, but it was really growing for me to, I remember sitting in the opening concert and just looking out in the audience and seeing who all was there and just kind of freaking out, just thinking like, whoa, I'm not ready to play a platform this big. And luckily I could soak it in for a day, and then it turned out okay. But man, it was a real important thing for me, you know, just career branding wise, but also just emotionally, because yeah, what a kind of rite of passage or something there. I mean, just a very scary thing to do. So anyway, real sincere and personal thanks to Fernando Meza, and man, thanks for joining us, buddy. It was great.
Absolutely. It's been my pleasure. So thanks for having me. And I'm very honored actually that I take the 50th episode of this. Congratulations, Casey, and everybody else, you know, on the success of this podcast. It's really terrific. So keep it going.
Yeah, thanks so much. Well, Megan, Ben, Laurel, thanks for your segments. And Owen, if you're out there, man, that was fun. We'll have to have you on just as yourself when we have time. So, all right, guys, we'll catch you. Next week is Jennifer Higdon, so keep an ear out for that one. And, yeah, take it easy. Thanks, all.
Awesome. Bye.
Bye.
Bye.